I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign.
Church all around the world is celebrating what we call Holy Week, Jesus riding into Jerusalem and ultimately facing his death on the cross and his resurrection from the grave. And today, again, is Palm Sunday. And if you have children at home or grandchildren, you can get some palms, or in the Northwest, fern branches make excellent palm branches. And in the New Testament, we learn that people were anticipating that this new king riding in, and so they laid down branches to honor him as the king, and they cried out a word, Hosanna, and that word literally means save. And what a time for us now to cry out to King Jesus and say, save us from our fears, Lord, save us from the uncertainty, save us from our sins. So let's cry out together, Hosanna, save us.
Sin, the people sing, the people
selfless faith, in selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna.
Together, Hosanna.
Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna.
You're all
together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me.
Lord Jesus, King Jesus, we are in awe that although you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, you came down into the darkness and you took the place of a servant. And we worship you today. We celebrate you today. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Well, hey, at this time, we are still using technology, exploring new technology. And via Zoom, we have Sue Kim, who's going to lead us in prayer today. Sue, can you hear us?
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you so much for serving us in this way. And I'm going to hand things over to Sue at this time. So good to see you guys.
Chronicles, before I pray, is one that you're all familiar with,
but it's been particularly meaningful to me in this time of crisis.
Two Chronicles 7:4.
If my people who call by my name will humble themselves, pray, and seek my face, and turn their wicked way, then will I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and heal their land.
I love that sense that God hears our prayers, and he responds to our prayers with his forgiveness.
Lord Jesus, we give you our highest praise and our deepest thanks that you were and are the long-awaited Messiah.
We declare, along with those who shouted on that first Palm Sunday,
blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Despite our current circumstances, we can celebrate this morning that your love, mercy, and grace, and power came to deliver and save us sinners.
For you are the same God then and now, and your goodness never changes.
At the same time, as we remember your triumphal entry into Jerusalem,
we also want to acknowledge that we share in the suffering of the people around the globe who are battling this pandemic.
We lament the trouble and suffering it has inflicted on people everywhere.
Where almost every nation is bowed low under the shadow of sickness and death.
We grieve the many tens of thousands of people who have lost their lives as a result of the coronavirus.
And may those who have lost loved ones find comfort in the sense of your presence. We lift before you all those who are seriously ill with this virus and ask for your mercy and healing to be poured out on them. We pray that you would save many from the jaws of death
and that they would recognize your healing hand in their lives.
We lament that it is those who are elderly, infirm, poor, and homeless who are most vulnerable to this disease. We remember particularly those places in the world where resources are already stretched to the limit because of famine, drought, and war,
and can only imagine how much more devastating this crisis will be for them.
Pour out your Spirit on your church and show us how we can come to their aid and be agents of your love, mercy, and goodness at this dark time. We lament all those who have lost their jobs and have their livelihoods threatened because of the downturn in the economy,
unable to pay their bills and even put food on the table.
Come to their aid, we beseech you.
Give your people a spirit of generosity and the will and means to share with others in need.
Although we recognize that we need to put the welfare of others before our own desire to come and go as normal,
we do lament the loss of physical freedom that has resulted from this outbreak.
We pray particularly for families who are under stress from being cooped up together for a long time,
trying to juggle the demands of work, home, and schooling.
We pray for an abundance of patience and loving kindness for them.
We pray for those at the opposite end of the spectrum who are at home alone, struggling with aching loneliness,
and ask for a sense of your abiding presence and comfort to be with them.
We lament the lack of preparedness for this pandemic and the chaos that has resulted in the way many governments are handling this pandemic.
We pray that leaders around the globe would put the welfare of their people uppermost
and would listen to the wisdom of those who have gifted the knowledge and understanding of how best to fight this.
We pray that countries would share rather than compete for resources,
and that a sense of our shared humanity and need for one another would emerge in this dark time.
We lift before you all who are putting their lives on the line to help others,
particularly health care, emergency and law enforcement,
grocery and all agricultural workers who keep our food supply functioning.
We lift all in the energy sector who works to give us light, warmth, and power,
and those who are working to maintain our water supply and sanitation services.
We remember those who work to maintain necessary transportation and communication services.
We are grateful for their selfless service and ask that you would protect them in their work
and give them a sense of your provision and strength and perseverance.
May this time of crisis be an opportunity for us to reflect on how we have contributed to the brokenness of the systems of this world,
whose weaknesses are being exposed in this pandemic.
We bring before you our systems of government, economics, healthcare, and our food supply system.
Show us where our own self-interest, arrogance, and indifference to the suffering of others,
our love of luxury, comfort, and convenience has contributed to the brokenness of these systems,
made our society more vulnerable to the ravages of this sickness.
We confess our sin and turn away from our selfish, broken ways of living.
We receive your forgiveness and ask you to fill us with your Holy Spirit.
Embolden and equip your people to live in a way that demonstrates that we love you with all our heart and mind and soul and spirit, and that we love our neighbors as we love ourselves. As death looms large in this pandemic, we pray for your grace to be poured out on all who are grappling with the meaning of life and the prospect of death. May many turn to you in these anxious times, recognizing the foolishness of self-reliance and seeing that you are the only one who can bring life and health and peace to all. We ask that believers around the world would be given opportunities to share the good news of your love, death, and resurrection with those around them this Holy Week through acts of kindness and loving words of truth. Let us not be like that original crowd on Palm Sunday who so quickly turned from praising you to condemning you a few days later. As we live through these tragic times and our faith is tried and tested, make us strong, firm, and steadfast, giving ourselves fully to your work and making us overflow with your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Sue. We will talk with you guys soon. Have a great day, and hopefully you'll continue to join us for service.
Thanks, Luke.
All right.
Well, hey, Bethel Church family. We have some really good news. I actually got word of this right after service last Sunday, and so we have a little video clip to share with you. Letting you know this good news that we have as a church family.
Hi, Bethel family. Just wanted to give you guys an exciting update with the Young family. We got somebody back. Everybody say hi to Amy.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for all your love and prayers and meals. It has been a huge help during this difficult time. And we just want to say that we're praying for each and every one of you, that our church family would stay healthy during this very different time we're living in right now, but we're thinking about everyone and sending love from our home to yours. You say hi? No?
Okay. Thank you all so much. All your support means the world to us, and God bless all of you.
Well, such good news. Thank you for those of you who've been praying, and we're just thrilled that the Youngs are back together as a family, and just wanted to share some good news with you all about that. Also want to thank our tech team and acknowledge we've had a couple technical difficulties this morning, but we're continuing to work to resolve them. So if you heard a bit of an echo, we are aware of that, and I think we fixed the problem. But we just want to welcome you to church online.
This is brand new for myself, for you, for many of us, but we are grateful that we have the opportunity to gather scattered all over the island and beyond to hear God's word, to worship together, and to be together virtually. I want to let you know of a few things happening around here. First of all, I want to thank those of you who have been able to give to our Deacons Fund. That is a ministry we have at Bethel that is set up to be able to help people with some often unexpected needs. And we are heading into a season where we anticipate some great needs in our community and beyond. If you need help financially, relationally, spiritually, please go to our website and under contact, you can select a special request or a prayer request. It will go directly to our office email. I'll get it, our leadership will get it, and we'll be able to get in touch with you and help you in any way you may need. Those of you who continue to want to give to our Deacons Fund or our General Fund, you can mail checks to our P.O. Box, 725 Vashon, Washington, or give online and just either select our Deacons Fund, which is designated to help those with unexpected needs, or our general budget you can pick on the online option. We're grateful for that. This Tuesday, we're going to try something brand new for us. I want to invite you to experience with us. We have a prayer meeting Tuesday night at the first Tuesday of every month at 7 p.m., and we're going to gather to pray, but we're going to do it online. So this Tuesday, April 7th, from 7 to 8 p.m., we're going to gather via Zoom. And if you're unfamiliar with that technology, it's okay. I am too. We are all learning. But what I would like you to do, if you want to be a part of our prayer service and actually see and hear from some other people in our church, you can email the church office, office@bethel-efc.org, and we will send you a link to that prayer meeting. Simply open that link and you will be able to join us. You just need to have some kind of camera, either on your cell phone or laptop. If you need help, please email the church office. We want to make sure that you have the opportunity to connect with others, especially during this time. It is Holy Week, so this coming Friday is Good Friday, and we are partnering again. This will be our third year of partnering with Vashon Island Community Church. We will be streaming live from here in our worship center at 7 p.m. April 10th at 7 p.m. We will have our Good Friday service streamed live here in partnership with Vashon Island Community Church. So please mark that on your calendar to log in and stream with us as we contemplate what Jesus did on the cross for us. And then Easter Sunday is going to be an unprecedented celebration. Easter is not canceled. Jesus has conquered sin and death once and for all. So we are going to celebrate. Traditionally, we have a big Easter breakfast. I encourage you to make a breakfast feast at your house. Try to wrap it up before we sing, but we want to encourage you to have a big breakfast, make some special memories with those who you are with, and if you're alone, we want you to know that we will be streaming live at 10 a.m. So be watching out for that to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and to worship together this coming Easter Sunday, which is April 12th. We are going through the book of Philippians as a church, and it's really interesting to see the correlation between the Apostle Paul and the way many of us feel. Maybe not to the extent that he was experiencing suffering, but just to remind us, Paul, as he wrote the letter to the church in Philippi, the book of Philippians, he was in prison, so he had lost his freedom. He didn't have a job, so his financial security was out the window, and he didn't know what his future would look like. So he was in the middle of all kinds of uncertainty and adversity, and yet he found and he had joy. And that's something that I want to learn personally from his life. But before we do that, I just want to let you know things are a little different for our family. We're in new rhythms, and maybe you're experiencing this as well, trying to figure out what does daily life look like. One of the things we are trying to do as a family is put screen time behind us and try to spend time outside in God's creation. And we have three small kids, And oftentimes they just want to lay around the house and be on a screen and watch some show or do an educational program on their tablet. And we're encouraging them, guys, let's get outside. Let's breathe some fresh air. Let's experience some creation. And yet they so often want to be on screens. And I'm that way too. Some days it would be so much easier just to lay around the house and watch TV. But I know if I get outside, I'm going to feel much better if I can exercise and get out. But our temptation is just to lay around and watch TV. And if you're doing that, no offense, but I encourage you to get outside. It's really good. And we have embarked on a new journey of starting a garden. And what we've seen with our children and ourselves in the last couple weeks is as we let go of the lure of screens and TV time and embrace the stillness of being outside, working with our hands in the dirt in creation, we're actually having a lot more joy. Now, we have our moments as a family of arguing and not getting along, but just the other day, I was in awe of watching my kids have a blast together outside. Now, they didn't think they would have a blast when we said, hey, toys away, screens away, we're going outside as a family. But as they put those down apprehensively and went outside, their peace and joy has gone up. And so often, we have things that we need to let go of to experience something greater. For our family, it was letting go indoor screen time to embrace outside time in the garden. But it reminds me that following Jesus is really this process of letting go of something that is seemingly good to get something that is truly great. And the Bible calls these seemingly good things sin. Things that we think are going to satisfy us and comfort us and fulfill us. And we cling to these things. The Bible calls them idols. And Jesus says, lay those things that you think will satisfy you, those seemingly good things, lay those down and embrace me. Embrace that which is truly great. We turn from sin, we embrace life in Christ. Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Author and theologian C.S. Lewis said it this way in his book, The Weight of Glory. He said, we are half-hearted creatures. We fool around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at sea. He goes on to say, we are far too easily pleased. Jesus showed up on the scene and he said, friends, leave your careers behind. Leave your ambition behind. Leave behind all the things that you think are so important and follow me. Trust me. Place all your confidence in me. And if you were able to download our notes from the front of our website or from the email that we sent out, I encourage you to follow along with us. At this time, if you would like to follow along and don't have notes, you can go to the front of our website, www.bethel-efc.org, and on the very front page, you can download these notes to follow along. But the main idea for the message this morning, Jesus was controversial, not because he claimed to be a good moral teacher, but because he claimed to be the King of Kings. Jesus was not crucified because he was a good moral teacher who passed out some good wise sayings and was nice. He was crucified because he claimed to be the King of Kings. He threatened those in existing power. And on Palm Sunday, we have palms and ferns, and these represent all those who came to meet Jesus as he was coming into Jerusalem as king, and they laid them down as a way to honor Jesus. But Jesus wasn't the type of king they thought he would be. Many thought he would be coming in on this powerful horse to overthrow the oppressive Roman government. But instead, Jesus came into town riding on a donkey. And he called people to a life that was a lot different than what they anticipated. Again, he called people to turn from the things that they thought were good, the things that they thought would bring them happiness. For many, they idolized the idea of their Messiah overthrowing the government and bringing peace to them in the here and now. But Jesus came in riding on a donkey to become the King of Kings by laying down his life for people, even his enemies. Tim Keller says that idols are anything we cry out to and say, "Save me, Hosanna." And many people on Palm Sunday cried out to Jesus, "Save me, Hosanna," but they wanted their salvation to come in a very different way than what Jesus actually did. As we look at Jesus as King in a very unique way, Dr. John Dixon, he's the Senior Research Fellow for the Department of Ancient History at Macquarie University in Sydney, Australia. And he talks about this idea of Jesus as King, not just a good moral teacher. And this is what he says. He says, Jesus was far more than a wandering philosopher handing out proverbs about doing good. Many people today say, yeah, I like Jesus. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do good to people. But Jesus was so much more than that. Much of what he said was far more confronting. Scholars agree that nothing was more central to Jesus' message than the kingdom of God. In the famous Lord's Prayer, he urged people to pray, "Your kingdom come." From the Old Testament to the Dead Sea Scrolls, Jews talked about a day when the Creator would prove himself king over the world, when he would overthrow injustice and restore order to this hurtful and chaotic planet. The kingdom of God would appear in a most unexpected way. And again, for many on the first Palm Sunday when Jesus was riding into Jerusalem, they said, finally, victory is here. Our king is here. We want to honor him and celebrate him and lay these branches down as he comes in to save us. Hosanna, save us. And then Jesus is on a donkey. And there was a lot of confusion. Even his followers thought they were following a victorious Messiah. And now all of a sudden they're in doubt because this man is about to be arrested and crucified. And this is so unexpected. This is not the way that kings behave. And yet this is how King Jesus lived and served us. I want to look at a few passages with you this morning. I'm going to give them to you ahead of time so that you have time to flip to them in your own Bibles, but we will have the slides on the screen. The first text is Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 5. This is Jesus as he enters into Jerusalem as king in an unexpected way. And then we're going to look at the Apostle Paul, the writer of Philippians. We're going to look at his acknowledgement as Jesus as king. Paul was one of those people who Jesus... He frustrated him. The followers of Jesus were a nuisance to Paul because they threatened his authority as a religious leader. But when Paul encounters King Jesus, his life is completely transformed. The Apostle Paul is one of the most convincing arguments to me that Jesus really is God in human flesh, that Jesus really is the King of Kings. So we'll be looking then at Acts chapter 9, verse 1 through 6. And then finally, we'll be reading our passage in Philippians today, Philippians chapter 3, verses 4 through 14, where we get to see firsthand what a life surrendered to King Jesus looks like. Before we dive into the scriptures, I want to invite you to pray with me, to quiet our hearts, and to be prepared to receive God's word, to hear God's word, and remove any distractions in our mind or anything happening around us. God, I pray that as we open your word together, that you would speak to us in a fresh way, that Jesus, we would get a clearer and more accurate picture of who you really are, not just a good moral teacher, but the King of Kings who came to seek and save the lost. And so Jesus, at this time, we just want to pause and we want to give you our full attention. Lord, if there's a sin we need to confess, if there's an anxiety we need to lay at your feet, Lord, we take time to do that now. Jesus, if you are truly King, there is nothing that we need to be afraid of. And so I pray that as we look to your word and what it says to us about you as King, I pray that it would encourage us and bring us hope today. We pray this in your name. Amen. Matthew 21, verses 1 through 5. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." And this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, quoting the prophet Zechariah in chapter 9, verse 9. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." And again, what an unexpected way for Jesus to reveal himself as king. Usually we want kings who are fierce and who fight for us. But Jesus was fierce and he did fight for us by dying on the cross to forgive our sin and to give us the hope of the resurrection. But so often we're clinging to these temporal idols and we want Jesus to fix the here and now. We cry out, "Jesus, save me from this situation." But Jesus said, "No, I have come to save you from your selfishness, your sin, and save the whole world from death and an eternity apart from God." So even though the Apostle Paul is stuck in prison, he says, "You know what? I recognize that Jesus might not save me from this prison cell and the adversity that I'm facing, but I am filled with joy because Jesus has saved me from my own sin and death." So let's look at the story of Paul when he first came to know Jesus as King. Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. And you'll notice the name is Saul. This is Paul's Jewish name. And after coming to know Jesus, he started to go by his Gentile name. And the significance of that is he gave up all connection to his past life, in which he was a Pharisee and was highly regarded among his peers. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. Jesus was very controversial, not because he was a good teacher, but because he claimed to be king. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus. So if he found any there who belonged to the Way, which was a name for the early Christians, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" And listen to this in verse 5. Saul says, "Who are you, Lord? I recognize now that you are far more than maybe I thought." Jesus responds, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." And from that moment on, Saul gave up all connection to his former life, embraced his Gentile name, Paul, and did exactly what Jesus told him to do. He met up with some of the original disciples and spent weeks with them learning about Jesus, and they indeed affirmed that Paul had met the risen Jesus and his life was transformed forever. So now let's make our way to Philippians chapter 3, where we get to see the result of a life surrendered to King Jesus. Paul challenges us as the reader, both his original audience and us today. Some people in the Philippi church took great confidence in their ability to be good, moral people, and they prided themselves in their high status before man. And Paul says, as a follower of Jesus, as someone who has Jesus as their king, we take a much different approach to life. We have a different attitude. And this is what Paul said to them, and this applies for you and I today. He says, if someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, in our own ability, in our own accomplishments, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, following the law of Moses, I was a Pharisee, an expert. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As far as righteousness based on the law, faultless. But he goes on to say, whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of His resurrection and participation in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Verse 12, not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal. Do you see the humility in Paul? But I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. What an example for you and I. Here's a man who had reason to boast in his own moral fortitude, in his own self-righteousness, in his own social status, and yet he said, you know what, all of that compared to knowing King Jesus, Paul said, it's garbage. It's a loss. It counts for nothing. So if you're taking notes with us this morning, if Jesus is truly King, here's a few applications for you and I. If Jesus is truly King, we must find our confidence in Him. And again, this runs counter to everything that comes natural to me. I often want to put my confidence in my good deeds, being a good person, having an upstanding reputation. While those are important things, when it comes to knowing Jesus, they pale in comparison. Paul says they're a loss, and we're really not as good as we think we are. So our confidence should always be in Christ and what He's done for us. And any good that results in our lives, we humbly say it's because of the grace of Jesus that I am what I am. Maybe our job title we find significance in, that's out the window. Our net worth, maybe we pride ourselves in leading an orderly life or biblical knowledge or some other accomplishments. And Paul would say, if Jesus is truly King, our confidence is in Him, not ourselves, not our flesh. In your notes under this point, there's a few key verses from our passage today. Paul says, if someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law or my ability to follow the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. So even in his prison cell, he has Christ. And Paul would teach us that is enough. That is where we find joy in adversity. Number two, if Jesus is truly King, we must consider everything a loss that's not from him or for him. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, Paul says, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. And for those of you that maybe had a life of sin where you embraced certain behaviors or attitudes and you've pushed them aside to trust Jesus, you realize, like, wow, there is so much worth in knowing Christ. All of that was a loss. All my time spent on these empty pursuits were such a loss. Everything that's not from Christ or for Christ will ultimately pass away. And I think during this time as a country and as a world, we realize how fragile everything is. Our jobs, our health, our freedom to go and do the things we want. So many things have been canceled. And I hope that we realize how fragile and temporary life is. But with Jesus, he is the eternal King of Kings. And he offers us assurance of salvation. He offers us assurance of eternal life. So Paul says, we have to consider everything a loss that's not from Jesus or for Jesus. All those things we pour so much time and energy into, we have to ask ourselves, will this last? Is this worth me pouring myself into? Are we willing to live open-handed life just like Jesus? Before he went to the cross, he said, Father, if there is any way for this cup to pass that I don't go to the cross, that would be great, but not my will, but your will be done. God, these are all the things that I am pouring my heart and soul into. These are my hopes and dreams. These are things that I want to accomplish. But I recognize if they're not gifts from you, if they're not gifts for you, they're going to be gone. They're going to be a loss. Finally, the third point, if Jesus is truly King, we must concentrate on the future that he has for us. And friends, so often I am concentrated on the future I want for myself. But Paul tells us in verses 13 and 14, brothers and sisters, these are people that Paul loves, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do. Paul is saying, I haven't reached maturity in Christ yet. I still have growth to do. But one thing I do, I forget what is behind, and I am straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. For Paul, he would say, brothers and sisters, do everything you can to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. The one who created and sustains all things, everything in this life that we enjoy is from him, all the good. And yet sin has entered into that good and marred it, and we have turned our gaze from Jesus to created things. We've stopped worshiping the Creator. We started worshiping created things and material things. And Paul says, friends, it's not too late. We can forget our days of idolatry. We can forget our days of self-confidence. And we can look forward to Jesus, trusting him with our future and concentrating on the future that he has for us, which again is living open-handed and saying, Father, not my will, but your will be done. Whatever happens, I just want to be with you. Whatever happens, I want to be found in you, faithful to you, trusting you with my hopes and dreams. So again, following Jesus is the process of letting go of something seemingly good. You know, man, I just want to lay inside and watch TV all day. Letting go of that to gain something truly great. Being with God, enjoying him, investing in the people that God created and loves. And we have an opportunity right now to shift our focus, to shift our gaze, to prioritize the things of God, loving him and loving others. So the question I want to leave you with is, who or what is your king? Who or what do you place your hope in? And I want to let you know that Jesus Christ invites you today to put your trust and hope in him. He is the King of Kings who came riding into town, not on a horse, but on a donkey, symbolizing peace and gentleness and service. He came to seek and save the lost, not exploit them for his own advantage. He came to serve you and I by dying the death on the cross that our sin deserved, so that we could be forgiven and our sin could be washed clean, and we could experience reconciliation with God and reconciliation with other people. And right now, we're going to move into a time of communion. And this is a practice that we have as a church given to us by Jesus himself. He knew that we are forgetful people, and we need tangible reminders of what he has done for us. And leading into Holy Week, Jesus gathered with his disciples and shared one last meal. And during that final meal, he taught them about this practice known as communion. And so if you're at home, I encourage you to get some kind of bread or cracker, wine or juice. The bread represents the body of Christ, which was broken for you, broken for me on the cross. And the wine or the juice represents his blood that was poured out for you, poured out for me. And blood really represents life. Jesus wasn't just a good moral teacher. He was God in human flesh. He lived in a human body, was tempted in every way that you and I are tempted, yet he never sinned. And out of his great love for you, out of his great love for me, he went to the cross so that we could have hope and healing and experience new life with God. I want to share with you from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 14 through 20. This is the account of Jesus sharing this supper with his disciples. Luke 22, verse 14. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. It's a very famous moment in history known as the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. Maybe you've seen pictures of it. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Kings don't usually suffer, but King Jesus willingly suffered for us. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. Again, one of those main themes that Jesus talked about. And this kingdom is ushered through the cross and his resurrection. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and he told them to divide it among you. And he tells them that they're not going to drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks to God, which is amazing considering what he was heading into this week. He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat together. And in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Let's drink together. Lord Jesus, we are in awe of what you willingly did for each and every one of us. Lord, you answered our cry, "Hosanna, save us," by laying down your life for us. I pray that we would grow in our dependence and trust in you, and that you truly would be our King, the King of our day-to-day lives, not just a good moral teacher and example, but the one who we give our trust to, the one who we obey. Jesus, thank you for your hope. Thank you for your joy that we can experience even in the midst of adversity. We're grateful, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, if you have a palm branch or a fern at home, I encourage you to get it And we are going to stand and cry out to Jesus, singing, "Hosanna, save us." Friends, we are praying for you as we go from here and continue to seek to know Jesus better and follow him as our King. I pray that you could experience joy this week, no matter what you face. God bless you, and we'll see you soon.